بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله الواحد القهار، الحمد لله العزيز الجبار، الحمد لله خالق السماوات والأرض، مكور الليل على النهار ومكور النهار على الليل. أحمده سبحانه وتعالى وأثني عليه الخير كله، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا هو وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن نبينا محمدا عبده ورسوله، صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعه بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، أيها الإخوة والأخوات، dear respected brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته, and welcome to a new episode and a new personality, a very great personality. We will be discussing a very great personality that we are going to discuss in this episode, inshallah, and the coming two episodes. This personality, we can't leave the life of the second generation without talking about this personality. In fact, because we ran out of time, we were planning to speak about other personalities, but because of the value and the position of this personality, we preferred to speak about it. We want to speak about Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab, Sayyid al-Tabi'een, the best of the second generation, as many scholars confirmed. Many scholars said, we haven't seen like Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab in terms of ibadah, in terms of ilm, in terms of fear of Allah Jalla wa Ala. Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab was a very distinguished personality. His father was Al-Musayyab, and his grandfather was Hazan. Both his father and grandfather were companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam met, or when Hazan, the grandfather of Sa'id, met the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, the Prophet asked him about his name. He said that his name is or was Hazan. Hazan means sadness. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as you know, does not like these names. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to like good names. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to like names that makes the person optimistic rather than pessimistic. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to him, "You are Sahl." Sahl means easy. He said, "Ya Rasulullah, this is a name that has been given to me by my parents. I don't want to change a name that has been given to me by my parents." As a result of this, they became sad, all of them. The grandfather, the father, and Sa'id himself. In fact, Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib said, "La zalat al-huzuna fina." Sadness continued in the family of my grandfather. And this was also manifested in the life of Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, and may Allah jalla wa'ala grant him the maghfira and rahma. Ibn Awn, we mentioned that Ibn Awn said, "I haven't seen like Raja ibn Hayawa in al-Sham and Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab in al-Madina and Muhammad ibn Sirin in al-Basra." Last time we mentioned that he said that, "I haven't seen like Shuraih, or I haven't seen like Raja ibn Hayawa in al-Sham, and Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab in al-Madina, and al-Hasan al-Basri." No, in fact, it was not al-Hasan al-Basri. In fact, it is Muhammad ibn Sirin. However, he said that, "I haven't seen like Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab in al-Madina." Many scholars said that Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab combined between hadith, fiqh, tariq, and others. One person said, "I haven't seen like Tawus." Another scholar said, "No, if he has seen Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab, he would have said, I haven't seen like Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab." Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab got married to the daughter of Abu Huraira, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. So that's why he was very close to the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. In fact, he was born in year 15. Umar ibn al-Khattab became the Khalifa on year 13, and Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab was born on 15 for Hijrah. That's why he attended many of the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum who used to live in Medina. And in particular, he narrated so many ahadith from Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, to whom he got married, to whom he got married his daughter. Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib was a distinguished person in terms of number of equalities, as we will see, insha'Allah. They said that Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib, this person never prayed, never missed a jama'ah. There were a number of narrations. There was one narration that he did not miss Takbirat al-Ihram for 50 years. Another narration said that he did not miss Takbirat al-Ihram for 40 years. In one narration, he said, I did not miss Takbirat al-Ihram for 40 years, and I did not see the back of a person for 20 years. What does that mean? He doesn't see the back of a person for 20 years means that he used to pray in the first line. In the first line. Here, let me just stop for a moment. Brothers and sisters, we see that many of us are completely neglectful and they are not putting utmost care in order to make sure that they are attending Salat al-Jama'ah, many brothers. And they use all types of excuses when they miss Salat al-Jama'ah. I remember that I read that Mujahid said that I attended one of the companions who attended Badr. And he asked his son one time, have you prayed in Jama'ah? His son said, yes, my father, I prayed in Jama'ah. Then the companion asked his son, have you attended Takbirat al-Ihram? Or have you missed Takbirat al-Ihram? He said, sorry, my father, I missed Takbirat al-Ihram. Then this companion said to him, wallahi, my son, the khair, the good that you missed is bigger than 90 camels. 90 camels. Subhanallah. Just by missing Salat, just by missing Takbirat al-Ihram, you are missing more than 90 camels. 90 camels at that time were the most luxurious mounts. So, in fact, he said, 90 camels, Sawdawat al-Aynayn. With this quality, they have like a certain type of eyes, which means that the most luxurious, expensive camels. Just by missing Takbirat al-Ihram, you will miss this khair. As if we say to people, if you miss Takbirat al-Ihram, you will lose a chance to gain 90 Mercedes or 90 BMWs. Do you think, brothers and sisters, if we say this to any person, he would miss that opportunity? Of course, he wouldn't, because he will say that he's crazy. Just by coming 2 minutes earlier in order to make sure that he attends Takbirat al-Ihram, he will get 90 cars, let alone 90 Mercedes or BMWs, of course. But this reflects the state of weak iman that many of us have. Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib said that he never missed Jama'ah for 50 years. In fact, he never missed Takbirat al-Ihram for 50 years, according to a narration, according to another narration, for 40 years. They said also, they mentioned that he used to pray from Isha to Fajr. In fact, they said that he used to pray continuously from Isha to Fajr for number of years. In one narration, for 50 years. And he used to pray Fajr with the wudu that he had for Isha. Now, whether that narration is an authentic narration or is a weak narration, but there is no doubt that such people used to do a lot of ibadah. They also mentioned that he used to fast continuously. He used to fast continuously, and he doesn't break his fast except in Eid, the Eidain, Eid al-Fitr and Eid al-Adha, because the Prophet ﷺ prohibited us from fasting during these 2 days. Why is this? And if you remember, brothers and sisters, we spoke about this issue. And we said the scholars have two views regarding fasting continuously. Is it good? Is it bad? Is it bid'ah? Is it sunnah? Shall we do it? Shouldn't we do it? And we said that if fasting does not stop you from any ibadah, any other ibadah, or any other obligation, or any other important thing, and also you don't consider this as an obligation upon you, and the third condition, you don't call people to do it, then it is up to you. You can do it. You can do it. There is no harm in doing it. And we said that if there is an old person who can afford to fast and he doesn't have other activities to be involved in, then if he wants to draw himself closer to Allah Jalla wa Ala, he can fast continuously. And if he wants to fast continuously except Friday, that will be also good. So whenever we hear that one of the tabi'een or one of the companions or one of the second generation or third generation used to do this amount of ibadah, we should think immediately of this answer. They said that Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib as well performed 40 hajj. He performed 40 hajj. And this shows, subhanAllah, that in salah he was excelling, in fasting he was excelling, in Hajj, he was excelling. Let us stop for a break, and inshallah we will continue this, the story of Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab after the break. Stay with us. Jazakum Allah khair.
Ask my son, should we perform wudu after eating mutton meat, after eating sheep meat? And the Prophet said, son, if you wish, it's not a must. And then he asked him again, he said, okay, do we have to perform wudu after eating camel's meat? And the Prophet said, yes.
Brother Muhammad's second question from Spain was about writing fictional stories for children. Is it permissible or not? For children, inshallah, it is permissible, because as long as the idea is good and the context is good and it's bringing up their morality, their behavior, their conduct, and you're trying and focusing to make them better people, I believe, inshallah, this is permissible.
He was asking about the ruling on banks, and I believe that he is asking about the banks in Nigeria. Is it halal to work for them or not? The majority of banks worldwide that do not apply the Islamic financing and transactions, it is forbidden for you to work in them, because they deal in interest, in riba. Any bank, anywhere in the world, you just go there and tell them, I need 100,000 euros. They say, this is 100,000 euros. You have to pay 7%, 8%, 12%, depending on that. And this is completely forbidden. This is riba.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back, brothers and sisters. We are discussing the story of Sa'id al-Musayyab, as you know. We said that he excelled in all fields of ibadah, fasting, prayer, hajj. One time he missed hajj, and they told him that you missed hajj because you have a big debt, or because you said that you had a promise, or you had like another, that when you see the Kaaba, you will make dua against Bani Marwan. So he said, no, not because of this. In fact, I used to make dua against Bani Marwan since the day I became an adult. He used to do dua against Bani Marwan. We said that, unfortunately, many of the Khulafa of Bani Marwan, they were involved in many unjust activities. And that's why many scholars consider them as zalimin, despite the fact that they agreed that they are the caliphs. So he was doing dua against them. I don't want to discuss the issue of making dua against the ruler, but if a person has the choice, he should make dua for the ruler, that Allah Jalla wa Ala guides him. But if he chooses for whatever reason to make a dua against the ruler secretly, then it is up to him. No one can stop him, because it was reported that a number of Salaf used to make dua against some zalim rulers. Of course, we are not talking about normal rulers. We are not talking about just rulers. No, we are talking about oppressors, zalim rulers, such as Al-Hajjaj, as we mentioned previously. Some scholars used to make dua against Al-Hajjaj. Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab said, when he was asked about why didn't he perform Hajj at that year, he said, it was not because I had this promise that whenever I see Kaaba, I will make dua against Bani Marwan, but because of another reason. And he mentioned something that indicates the reason why he didn't make Hajj. He said, many people, they take loans from others, and they use the money that they have taken as loans from others to perform Hajj, and then they fail to pay off the debts. And he said, this is not right. The person who wants to go to Hajj, he should not have the burden of others' people's rights on his shoulders. He should go Hajj when he is going to Hajj by himself. This statement was narrated to Al-Hasan al-Basri. You know that Al-Hasan al-Basri lived in the same period of time. Al-Hasan al-Basri, we said that he was born on year 21. Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab was born on year 15. So they were living in the same period of time, although Al-Hasan al-Basri was living in Basra mainly. He spent some time in Medina, but Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab continued all of his life in Medina. Whether they met in Medina when they were young, whether they met or not, Allahu A'lam. But Al-Hasan al-Basri heard about this story from Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab, and then he said, no, if that is the case, means if everyone has a debt, he wouldn't go for Hajj, or he should not go for Hajj. He said that if that is the case, then many of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam wouldn't go for Hajj. And here we say, no, that is not true, the statement or the comment of Al-Hasan al-Basri. In fact, if we were to say what is more correct is the statement of Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab, because if a person has a debt, then his main priority should be to pay off the debt, because the first thing he will be questioned at the grave is the rights of others. And even the shaheed, as we mentioned, he will have his sins, all of them, forgiven when he die, except debts. That's why most of the scholars believe that if you have a debt, you can't go for Hajj. Put your attention to pay off the debt. Of course, there are some exceptions for this. I'm talking about the general ruling. There are some exceptions, but those exceptions cannot be explained now. You need maybe to ask some trustworthy scholars. Anyway, that was the statement given by Al-Hasan al-Basri regarding this. That was his opinion. Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, it was clear in his personality that he did not like to have debts. He didn't like to let others have favors upon him. He doesn't want himself to be humiliated by needing other people's rights or other people's wealth. He doesn't want to put himself in that position. That's why when he was imprisoned for some time in Medina, and we will come to that story, his daughter started to cook some good food for him. And then when they used to send the food to him, he wrote to his daughter and he told her, don't do this. This is, in fact, he told her, this is what the governors want us to do. They want us to spend all of our money while we are in prison. Then we don't have any source of income except to go and beg them. And I don't want to do this. So I prefer not to spend the money for food while I am in prison. And I prefer, oh my daughter, that you save this money so we don't need other people. And that was clear in the personality of Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. He used to have some money and he used to give it to some people to trade and do some business, and he used to take the income of this money. In fact, they say that he used to wear very good clothes, very nice clothes, and he used to praise this because he said this is the way a scholar should honor him from being humiliated or being in a position where he needs the help and support from others. And this is a very important lesson for us brothers and sisters, in particular for our brothers. If you are a talib ilm, if you are a scholar, if you are of a, as they say, religious status, then try to suffice yourself by yourself. Don't humiliate yourself before the leaders or governors or emirs. Even in fact, before rich people. And they said, among the statements of Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab, he said, don't go for Hajj with a rich person who will finance your trip. It will be difficult for you. Why? Because if he tries to finance your trip, you will try to simulate him in the way he is spending. You will spend as he spends, and that will be difficult for you because you don't have money as he had. And if you just accept him to support you throughout the journey, this is humiliation. And a person, a Muslim, should not humiliate himself. That's why a person should not go for Hajj with such a person. Of course, this is just a suggestion from Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib, and always, as we always say, that the context differs from one situation to another situation. But generally speaking, the Muslim should not put himself in a position where he is lowering himself. And as you know, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sahbihi wasallam said, the upper hand is better than the lower hand. The upper hand is the hand that gives, and the lower hand the hand that takes. One time, Abdul Malik ibn Marwan came to Medina. And then after that, he was on the deathbed. He wrote to Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib a statement that he said, Abdul Malik ibn Marwan, he said, I wish if I was not the Khalifa, and I wish if I had a little income and just do ibadah, seclude myself to Allah Jalla wa Ala to do ibadah and to do righteous deeds, and I am free from the responsibilities of money and the wealth of Muslims. Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab, when he heard about this statement, he had a very nice comment. He said, Alhamdulillah, that when they die, they come to us, we don't go to them. When they die, those rich people, those caliphs, they come to us. What does they come to us mean? Means they know that what we used to do is the best thing and what they used to do is wrong. They used to be involved in many doubtful matters, and they were not careful about their akhirah, and they were focusing on their dunya, and hence when they die, they regret, or when they are about to die, they regret what has happened or the way they spent their life. This is what it means. Now, see, we are not saying, we are not recommending that the person should devote himself for ibadah completely and should not be involved in other activities. As we said in the beginning of this series, that the person should be balanced, and it depends on the situation. Anyway, I have to stop here for the end of the episode, and inshallah we will continue the story of Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab in the following episode. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.